In the revision part of Unit 6. Here we will be looking into the hash based indexes. In this hash based indexes, the main thing was we will go with a equality search. There will be some buckets. Whenever a value is equals to the bucket value, then it is done and there it is posting up the bucket there. So as far as hash function is going to be concerned, it takes up two elements, one called as a random and two it is going to called as uniform. One it is calling it as random, another it is calling it as uniform. So hash based indexing does two mechanisms. One, it is towards static hashing, another it is going to be towards the dynamic hashing. One, it is called as static hashing, two, it is going to be called as dynamic hashing. And the trade-offs, yeah, they are more or less equals to the B plus tree, which we had a prior discussion. And similarly, the indexed sequential access methods, which we had a discussion a couple of days ago. Now, coming to the hash-based techniques, there are two ways where we can put up the hashing scenario. So the primary way of bringing the hashing scenario will be the static hashing. The primary way will be the static hashing. So in this static hashing, we have the primary pages which are going to be very fixed. That is 0, 2, up to n minus 1. The elements are going to be fixed and they are going to be allocated according to the hash code to the appropriate bucket it was generated. And if the bucket size is going to be full, then it looks up for a overflow. If the bucket size is equals to full, then it looks up for a overflow. So now here is an example which it is going to bring up keys, and key is going to generate a hash function. How is this hash function generated? Means it is going to use a formula called as hashing of key modulo n. Hashing of key modulo n. So hashing of key modulo n is equals to the bucket to which the ATA entries in which k belongs. So that is what we are representing. The very first thing we call here as the primary bucket pages. And if the bucket is full, it is going to call like a pointer or it navigates to the overflow pages. Overflow pages, they are linked to the appropriate bucket here. Now, coming to the static hashing. So static hashing, it is going to contain some data entries. And how is this static hashing done? Means it is going to be represented with the f of n, which is purely based on a search key with record r. And it is going to distribute between a range of 0 to m minus 1. Now, at this point, hash key is going to be generated with a variable a into the key what we are going to check plus b. So a and b we are going to call here as a constants. And if it is a simple way of representing the things, that is the primary page followed by one overflow page, it is fine. But if there are multiple overflow pages, then obviously it is going to degrade the performance. Obviously, it is going to degrade the performance. So there, the concepts where the degradation is going to be done. Therefore, the concepts of extendable hashing and the concepts of linear hashing. So they were meant to explore from the static hashing. So one of such example we are going to call here as a dynamic hashing. So as far as dynamic hashing is going to concern, the problem with static hashing is that it does not expand nor shrink dynamically as the database grows up. So here there are ways where we can delete a table. That means that memory is in use. There are ways where memory will be expanded if the table entries are more. That means expansion of buckets is possible, contraction of buckets is possible. But as far as the static hashing is going to be concerned, the primary pages are going to be fixed, the primary bucket pages are going to be fixed, and if the data is empty or full, it is no material. The things has to be available as this model, followed by the overflow content. So this concept is purely fixed up. Now, as far as dynamic is going to be looked into it, it says that it is going to provide in which the data buckets can be added at the runtime, can be removed from the database if there is no demand. So if there is no requirement for the database, then the bucket it is going to be removed. The other forms of dynamic hashing, we are going to call it as extended hashing. The other forms of dynamic hashing, we are going to call here as extended hashing. So in order to compute this extended hashing, we are going to make a hash function, and that hash function, it is going to make a procedure of large number of values and only a few are used initially. So in this model, we are going to bring up a hash function where it is made available to the larger number of values. So as told, the memory will be utilized very well, memory will be utilized very properly. So whenever there is a grow of data structure, yeah, it is encouraged. If there is no grow of data structure or the database, yeah, it is not going to improve. So expansion and contraction of the database is going to be seen. So that is the reason why we can say it is shrinking frequently. So these are some of the advantages where the dynamic memory, dynamic hashing is going to come into picture. We talked about the single hashing structure. Next one, we talked about the dynamic hashing structure. Now let's look into the third concept, that is extendable hashing. So as far as extendable hashing is going to be concerned, we are going to have these elements. We are going to have these elements in form of buckets. So when bucket is going to be full, what we are going to do is we are going to give a overflow. So in order to see that such overflows are not going to happen, instead of overflow, they are going to be organized by doubling. So I can say part 1, part 2, part 3, part 4. So movie 1, part 1, movie 1, part 2. In the same model, there is bucket number 5, and that bucket number 5, when it is full, another instance of the bucket number 5 will come. So a doubling is going to be one of a solution which was seen up with a word called as extendable hashing. So they are going to use up the pointers, they are going to use up a directory structure and see that there is no overflow pages. So this was the key takeaway what we need to understand. So extendable hashing, it is going to be organized with a directory structure of points, that is point number one. Second point was, it is going to see that there is no overflow. There is no overflow. Fine. Next one, what we are going to illustrate here was, the directory structure, it is going to be with an array of size 4. So once we are going to say 4, And if we are going to take up the directory size as a two variable, that is a binary structure, because 4, we can say it is 2 power 2, 2 square. So what will be the 4 combinations? The 4 combinations will be 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1. So these 4 items, they are going to be part of the global directory structure, and the depth is going to be mentioned as 2. That is, number of bits it is going to occupy. So number of bits it is going to occupy. Now we say it is 2 bits occupying for the global depth. Next one. Next one was, as we mentioned, a index value, like a metadata value in the global structure. Now it is partitioned into 4 again. Now it is going to be partitioned into 4 again. And these 4, we are going to call them as a part A, part B, part C, part D. That is bucket A, bucket B, bucket C, and bucket D. So they too have the same number of bits which are going to be common. So we say here global depth is equals to some local depth value. Next one. Let us take 4, let us take 12, let us take 32, let us take 16. So when I'm going to put up 16, it will be 1, 0, 0, 0. Ones and 4 zeros. So what are the last 2 elements? 0, 0. Now let me take 12 here. 1, 1, 0, 0. So what are the last 2 elements? Again, they are 0, 0. So we make up a similarity, we make up the content into binary form and see that whichever buckets are going to fall in a same entropy, those elements we are going to bring up and put this as a solution part. So this it is going to happen for bucket A, bucket B, bucket C, and bucket D based upon the available number of items. So now what we have talked? We talked that there are 2 words. One we call it as global depth. Another we are going to call it as local depth. The very first directory structure, which is made at the central database, we call here as a directory system, and which it is going to be propagated to the user areas, where the user areas, they are going to build up the data pages and store the content in the form of depth. So these 4 elements, bucket A, B, C, and D, they are going to provoke the local content. Now, if I'm going to have a value of h of r is equals to 5, so now 5, it is going to be written as 101, 101. So obviously 5 will be included into the bucket 5. Now assume the node structure is full. Now assume again, we need to have the value called as 5 to be reinserted again. But here the bucket was full. What we can do is we can split and see that the same bucket is going to be allocated to the new page, which it is going to be redistributed. Why the same bucket? Because when I'm going to say it is 5, that is 101, the last 2 digits are going to be common, that is 0 and 1. So that is the reason why we are going to move in this distal mode format. So now we had a global depth, and we have seen the word called as a local depth. Next comes. The inserting operation, and this inserting operation we are going to call here as for 20. So let us look into the 2 diagrams before and after. The before structure, what you can see here was global depth is 2, local depth is 2, and we made the structure. 20 was originally 16 and 8, 4, 2, 1. So it is satisfying with the first three elements. So for the last two bits positions will be 0, 0. But 20 was not fitting at this position. Therefore, we are going to split up the bucket. That is bucket A. And second thing, bucket A after splitting. Now, why did we bring 4? Why did we bring 12 along with 20 is the question. Earlier, 4 and 12 were inside bucket A. But now when we made a split, why 4 and 12 came and sat here? The reason was 4 is going to be written as 1, 1, 0. 12 is going to be written as 1, 1, 0, 0. So now you can see that the third element is going to be 1, which is not available in 32 and 16. The third element in 32, 16 was 0. But the third element from the left hand side for 4, 12 and 20 is going to be 1. Therefore, we break up the things into two parts. Is this working? No. Still, it has to be penalized to three-level data structure. Why three-level data structure? Because we don't want to see any overflow here as per the theoretical concept is concerned. So to fix up that overflow concept, what we can do is we will convert the two-level depth to the three-level depth. We will convert the two-level depth to the three-level depth. Then what we are going to save us, it is 4, that is nothing but 0, 1, 0. So 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0 for 12 and 1, 0, 1, 0. So there for 20 also we are going to get this answer. Therefore, what we are going to illustrate here was 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, the first two digits in 0, 0, the first two digits in 1, 0, 0, they are same. So local depth problem is solved. But when coming to the global depth here, one more bit is going to be incremented. So that is the reason why these 4, 12 and 15 are mapped to another issue. And the depth it was written as 3. So now you can see that instead of extension, we can go with the splitting of the content. So when we are going to delete an element towards the extendable hashing, the thing was wherever a markup, wherever a merged or a split image has been deleted, the items which are going to be dependent on those contents will also be eliminated. So this is what we are going to tell. That means if I'm going to work out on this global depth body, now much emphasis if it is given to this content, we may not look into the other aspects, which is in level 2. So those elements, they will be disqualified. To eliminate that, what was the decision it was taken up as far as the operator is concerned? So you can see here the extendable hashing. So if there is a delete operation, then it can be merged with a split image and it can be pointed out in a directory value rather than using the same. So once again, the data, the dynamic hashing, what we are going to tell was the problems which is solved or which is not solved by the static hashing, or the drawbacks of static hashing is going to be advised via the dynamic hashing. That is first key takeaway. And these two companies, that is one with the extendable and static and with the dynamic, all these elements, they are going to deal with level 2 depth or level 3 depth. That is, the data can be grown, can be represented. The data can be shrinked, can also be represented. So what was the advantage was they will see that it is unused memory lying can be utilized properly if it is going to be in growing phase. And you can neglect the data and it can be further used by other data content when we are going to make a shrinking operation. So the other name for extendable hashing, we called it as dynamic hashing, that we have discussed. Next one was a word called as linear hashing. So the other dynamic hashing, yeah, we have linear hashing and we have the extendable hashing. So we have already discussed about the extendable hashing. Now we are talking about the linear hashing. So what was this linear hashing doing was, it is going to solve the problems which are going to be created with the long overflow chains and without duplicates or directories. That is point number one. Second point was, we have the hash functions with hash 0, hash 1, and hash 2, which we can say that hash key is equals to hash key of mod, etc. And it is going to be hashing key, it is going to be range up between a minimum value of 0 to maximum value of n minus 1. And it is also with the nth position at d naught, the digit number it is going to be represented. Now, how we are going to work with this linear hashing? So working with linear hashing was that we have the directory structure which is going to be using the overflow pages and which it is going to split into the round robin fashion. So what is round robin fashion here? Now I am going to have the initial bucket, which is shown in a red box. Now the bucket has to be split. That is from level H, it has to be incremented to level plus 1. It has to be incremented to level plus 1. So what we can do here was buckets, they are going to be split and they are going to split in such a way that they are going to be linearly taken up. You can see the spread, bucket is full, then it is moving to the next as in a sequential form. So such images we are going to call here as a split image. So there is no question of overflow here. So this is the advantage what the linear hashing is going to provide. So yeah, again, in linear operation towards hashing, we can do up a insert operation. So insert operation, yeah, we will find the buckets by applying which level it is, which is the next level. And if it is going to insert into a full, then we are going to add a overflow page, not a overflow bucket, right? So that is the key takeaway what we need to understand here. So that element it is going to be split. And therefore, the next item is going to be next consecutive cell is going to be allotted and it is going to be incremented to next. So we work in a model called as a round robin at this pace. We keep on doubling the directories, we keep on incrementing the directories, and we can move to split next or we can move to the increment next. So whether we need to split the bucket and give it to the next are used to the same, because if there is any overflow content that they will be occupying that. If not, we will move to the next bucket. So in this model, we are going to solve out the example towards the linear hashing. So in linear hashing, yeah, again, we are taking up two hash functions, that is hash 0 and hash 1. So if it is working with 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1, we take it up with the initial type of hash function H0. Later on, it is with the three values 0, 0, 1. So again, you can see if I'm going to write 9, 9 is represented as 1001. So 1001, 001, it is taking up the next hash 1. And if it is considered only for the 2 digits, 1001, so the last 2 digits are 0 and 1. Therefore, we are going to get 0 and 1. So in this model only, we are going to work out. So primary pages are there. And split pages, here we are going to say it is overflow, and they will be occupied consequently after the content is going to be inserted. So these are the two variations which are going to happen for the hashing operations. That is, we talked about linear hashing and we talked about dynamic hashing. So the static hashing, which we call it as linear hashing, it is going to suffer with long overflow chains, but as far as hash-based techniques, it is going to work with equality and there won't be any ranges. So we keep on splitting the node, nor we keep on doubling the nodes, and we will shift from one location to another location, and it keeps off all the directories that are going to be periodically used. So these are some of the advantages what the extendable hashing, that is the version of a dynamic hashing, is going to be provoked. So these are all regarding the inputs towards the linear hashing and hash-based action.